And that's how all these structural relationships between participants can actually go on. In fact, you know, when you're working just on your machine, the traditional model of personal computing, which is highly individualized, is in fact one where you know, you're just working on your machine, and you have these contingent little chaotic things called, oh, I'll send an email. Now, the interesting thing is that if I'm working on my machine doing a word file, so if I'm a kid at school and I'm writing an assignment, well, you know, the assignment might be called Document 7 or My Assignment. It's lost to anybody else because the desktop, you know, well, unless you're working in a lab and you've got some system for putting away files, you know, people's getting into someone else's machine is impossible. It's really your private space. You know, where do you find what you're looking for? It really has to be, you know, a space where you're just working by yourself on this independent artifact called, you know, My Assignment or something. Now, this is a paradigm that we call personal computing. And what I want to describe the possibilities of cloud computing. So I'm not so much interested in the technology, the server-based technologies, but the social relationships. And I think that that's such a big shift in the potential social relationships that I want to call that interpersonal computing. So the personal computer is a product of the essentially the 1980s. And now we're in a phase with Web 2.0 and cloud computing of what I would call interpersonal computing, where we can interact with each other in all sorts of ways. Now, this is the difference. If that student is doing their assignment at the moment and it's in a cloud environment, it's on a server, they can be working on that assignment anytime, any place. Remember our two confinements, the confinements of time and space. They can be working on that at any time. And other people can be interacting around it. They can be writing peer reviews, they can be writing comments, and anytime the teacher can see what they're doing. So immediately it's a much more social and much more potentially much more interactive space as well. So what's the affordance? Well, the affordance is that what tradition, the interaction which ideally and traditionally happened in a classroom, which is, you know, student discussion with the teacher, teacher asking questions, teaching talking about things, teaching watching what the students are doing, students answering teacher questions, having a discussion perhaps, that can actually now happen in any space because we have moved the student's work off a personal computer onto a server, and we've built these structured relationships around that work. So that's a very, very big shift, and it's a shift which makes it to have intense peer-to-peer and teacher-to-student interactions that can be done anytime, any place. You don't have to have a classroom to do that. So for me, just to sum this up, this is how we really transcend those old pedagogical boundaries, separations, confinements of space and time. The walls of the classroom is the space, and scheduling and timetable is those constraints of time. This is a very big shift. Now, of course, in a sense, to return to where I started, we always did versions of this in the form of homework and distance learning. We always wanted to try and have learning happening outside the classroom, but now it can happen in a much fuller and much more complete kind of way. Just off on a little tangent now, I want to mention the image I was using in the corner of the slide. Along the way, I've got some examples of little educational heroes or perhaps even anti-heroes that I want to just mention tangentially as I go along. The person in the bottom of this slide is a man by the name of Petrus Ramus, who lived in the 16th century. And he's a person who's been incredibly forgotten over the years, and forgotten for really good reasons, because he sort of changed the world and did nothing all at the same time. So let me explain what I mean by that. He was a professor at the University of Paris, and to be sort of a little bit facetious about it, he didn't have an original idea of his own. He simply regurgitated rhetoric from the classics, dialectics from the classics, geometry from the classics, and this was classical sort of late medieval learning that he was reproducing at the University of Paris. But what he did is he invented, in a way, invented the modern textbook. So he took these ideas and he divided them into little bits and ordered them from simpler bits to more complicated bits. He simplified them, he digested them, he summarized them. So if I asked you to go and work out what Aristotle means by logic or what Aristotle means by rhetoric from the text of Aristotle, it's a fair bit of work because these things were not designed as pedagogical texts, they're philosophical texts. So he simplified things and laid things out logically. But what he did is he laid things out also spatially on pages. There was a section on this and a heading for that and so on. So in a way, there are 1,100 editions of Ramus' books in the 16th century. He's perhaps the most sold and most used author. And he creates this modern artifact called the textbook. So as I say, not an original idea in the whole opus, but nevertheless, he builds a kind of characteristic modern information architecture. Now, just as a piece of trivia, he ends up being murdered by his students. So I don't know whether he was murdered by his students because the textbook was so terrible, but I think Paris was a pretty tumultuous place in the 16th century.